thanks, Derek, and dear colleague, many thanks for giving me the chance to be here and to talk about the application of diffusion NMR to nanopurse materials and in particular to zeolites as their most important representative. Tracing back the history of NMR in Germany leads us to the end of the 20s, beginning 30s, when Werner Heisenberg was chair of theoretical physics in Leipzig, and Felix Bloch was his first PhD student. The menace of fascism forced Felix Bloch to leave Germany, and so he started in the United States his new work, as you know, and he is at the top of a series of Nobel Prize winners in the phenomenon he has detected, the NMR. Meanwhile, Germany collapsed into ruins in a translational sense, and in reality, like the old physical institute. But the people working there had a great enthusiasm. After the bad time of war, doing something reasonable for the mankind, and around Adolescence, there were young people doing their PhD and diploma work in these ruins, and he advised them, just have a look into these papers on NMR, try to reproduce these experiments. And Harry Pfeiffer, one of his students, was successful and within his diploma work made the first NMR machine able to produce NMR signals, definitely in Germany, but most likely also in continental Europe. He and Arthur Lesher became a condensation point of NMR research, well recognized even beyond the Iron Curtain. And it was a particular pleasure to hear from, you see, from Richard Ernst on one of his talks in Leipzig to refer to Leipzig as the East Pole of magnetic resonance. I came to Harry Pfeiffer at the end of the 60s asking for a topic for diploma work and the thesis. And this is a photograph made 20 years later on. The group has become larger. Harry Pfeiffer looked still the same. And in this time, he started with research with zeolites. And for physicists, zeolites are very attractive, not only because they are commercial relevance. It's told that by the use of zeolites, the annual benefit of petrol refinery is of the order of $10 billion. Mainly, it's of interest due to the well-defined structure and the well-defined positions of the cations within the material and the option that molecules are sitting within these cages. The information so far deduced for the molecules was mainly taken from NMR relaxation measurements, from the information about the correlation time. And so Harry Pfeiffer was puzzled, reading in Science at this time about diffusivities of water, which was in our focus, in zeolites. By combining these data with the correlation time, he received physically unreasonably large jump lengths. The measurements were performed by the novel technique introduced by John Tanner And of course, now in Leipzig, we became interested in this technique. It is true that at this time, Dieter Freude had already applied the constant field gradient for diffusion measurements, but the relaxation times more than the zeolites became too small, and it was not applicable anymore. And so Harry Pfeiffer asked me to start within my PhD work to build such a machine and to reproduce the experiments by Boudin and co-workers. And you may imagine that I am deeply moved to meet John Tanner here, by the way, for the first time, who is at the beginning of my career. It's really, John, wonderful. Thanks. And Harry Pfeiffer was wise enough to give me the help of colleagues, Wilfried Haig, you see him. He helped me in the instrumentation, and later on, Günther Seifert. And of course, I mention with pleasure that finally also Patrick Alvosas, many of you should know him. He went to Wellington working with the dear late Paul Callahan, and he did a lot of work in instrumentation during his diploma work and later on the PhD, and as a junior professor even in Leipzig. So still, we are working with his devices. But of course, I have to emphasize that the second half of my PhD was possible due to exactly our position beyond the Iron Curtain. This brought me into contact with Sergei Petrovich Zhdanov in Leningrad. And not only that, I could practice my Russian, which I learned at school, and that he and his wife became good friends of our family. No, most importantly, we got zeolite crystallites, the largest one available at this time. And now I had wonderful material to reproduce what Boudin has measured. And it turned out that it was a wonderful field for all my further research with many fantastic physical questions, and about a few of them I will talk in the remaining 22. Yeah, okay, exactly, I don't have to count it, 22 minutes. At first, the different diffusivities in zeolites, which now could be measured due to the availability of well-defined large gradients. And the most essential point was, of course, we could now measure with large crystals and with small crystals. This paper has been published in the Zeitschrift für Physikalische Chemie in Leipzig in German. And I recently noticed that this paper was the most cited one within 15 years. And then I noted, yes, it's a worthy succession of Adolf Fick, who has, by the way, published 100 years later his fundamental paper on the diffusion equations as well in Leipzig. And of course, now with these big crystals, it was clear. What did the people around Michel Boudin, they have looked at the long-range diffusion, which we now refer to for displacement much larger than within the individual crystallites. While we, with the big crystals, were able to measure unambiguously the intracrystalline diffusion. And now the world was fine, these diffusivities were smaller as those which has been measured previously. And in addition, having such wonderful big crystallites, and in addition, our powerful machine, we were even able to measure even within the small crystals by going to sufficiently low temperature, displacements which were small enough that they remained unaffected by the walls, and so we could measure intracrystalline diffusion even in these small. You see, these are the data for the large crystals. So altogether, we notice quite different options for measuring diffusion in zeolites. You see the genuine intracrystalline one here, and then the long-range diffusion with large displacement, and then effectively the restricted diffusion within one crystal, where under the given conditions the molecules remain restricted. But you know, all this might be much nicer be presented within the scheme developed from the original Tanner-Tayskal relations, just taking the Fourier transform, and then you see immediately that by Fourier transforming the spin echo attenuation, you get the mean propagator. This means this maximum information about the statistics, the movements within the system, the probability that during the observation time, an arbitrarily selected molecule out of the sample has been shifted over distance z in the direction of the field gradients. And this can now be nicely plotted in the given case, and we may distinguish a couple of situations just immediately before, refer to intracrystalline or the different diffusivities, now the propagators, always 1/2 is presented, and you see these are the propagators for genuine intracrystalline diffusion. These for restricted diffusion, a technique which later on was referred to as dynamic imaging. This is quite a quite expensive microscope. So you get all this information. And also very interestingly, in this case of the long-range diffusion, you easily understand that the effective diffusivity is a product of the diffusivity in the intact crystalline space, gas-like diffusion or Knudsen diffusion, and the relative number of molecules. And so at sufficiently high temperatures, P inter will become very, very high. D inter is anyway very high. And so it happens that the long-range diffusivity is often larger than the diffusivity in the neat liquid, simply as a consequence of the high intercrystalline or mesopore, wherever the molecules are, diffusivities. Of course, the most important message at this time did refer to intracrystalline diffusion. This did in fact mean a shift in the paradigm of zeolite research and technology, saying that what so far was assumed to be the intracrystalline diffusivity was incorrect. And so far one hadn't the chance to look into the interior and monitor the displacement. One simply looked at the rate of uptake and implied diffusion limitation and came to these data. In reality, the mobility for a number of systems was much larger, up to 5 orders of magnitude. About the origin of this discrepancy, I want to talk in my next little section about structure diffusivity correlation detected in nanoporous materials with host materials. And I go back to the propagator representation and look now at this situation where you are able to discriminate between the narrow component corresponding to those molecules which remain in the interior of the crystallites. You see this amount is decreasing with increasing time, and simultaneously the broad part is increasing. And so you get exactly, by looking at this time-dependent information from conventional tracer exchange experiments, but in a microscopic way and at a high speed, you can attain even milliseconds. And what is, of course, very agreeable is that being a Fourier transform of the propagator, we get the same information simply by looking at the spin echo attenuation, seeing the first fast part which corresponds to the broad part of the propagator, and thus plotting this part. This is nothing else than the tracer exchange curve. And worse, you may also look at the amount of molecules still within the individual crystallites, plotting this in this way, you get often a straight line, and from the straight line you get also the rate constant of this exchange between the interior of the crystallites and the surroundings. Both options are possible. Either just take this area, this is the theory of the moments, statistical moments we have adopted from chromatography, and in both cases you get the real time constant of exchange. But of course we dispose of the intracrystalline diffusivity and the size of the crystals. Thus, by looking at the ratio, we can determine the mean lifetime which would result by diffusion limitation. And if this real lifetime is much, larger than this value, then we know we do have barrier limitation. And this was exactly the case in most of the systems where this discrepancy was observed. Surface barriers were thus detected. There's a nice option to look at this special case of restricted diffusion. You see, if the long-range diffusivity is very small, molecules are confined to the crystals, and that is a situation like we know it from macropores, and so one may nicely apply the formalism developed by Mitra Sen for restricted diffusion, plotting the diffusivity as a function of the square root of time. You get decaying curves. Even we were really surprised that we have to imply second order approximations, that there's a deviation from the straight line. This nicely fits for N-hexane. This is a big molecule which doesn't like to go into the gas phase. But if instead of N-hexane we take tetrafluoromethane, a small one, then we have the opposite situation. Fast diffusion in the gas phase, and so we may even apply the formula developed, as well developed by Mitra and Sen for absorbing walls. Since all molecules entering or colliding with the surface, they go outside and diffuse so far away that they don't contribute to the signal. So this was a nice, totally different application of diffusion zeolites owing to the diffusion NMR. But now we were really surprised to find a similar pattern in wonderful MFI types, zeolite silicolites. They looked really nice, and restricted diffusion could have been expected only for much larger displacements, since the diameters were large. But no, there was really a restriction, and it was found that these data were nicely reproduced by assuming that in the interior of these nicely looking crystallites, there were barriers with a spacing of, this was just comparison with Monte Carlo simulations, with a spacing of 3 micrometers and an activation energy exceeding that of intracrystalline diffusion by about 20 kilojoules. So at high temperature, there were no barrier anymore. The thermal energy was sufficient. And so you could really find this all, and nobody was aware of this before, since, of course, this is not so relevant for structural investigation. And so I thought about a saying I've seen in my medical doctor's practice. Yeah, the diagnosis, including NMR imaging, is now so good, there are no healthy persons anymore. No, there are also no perfect crystals anymore. So far, we looked at diffusivities of the guest molecules, mainly by proton NMR and fluoride NMR, but of course it is also possible for cations lithium-7. And in fact, quite recently, we succeeded in looking in parallel at lithium diffusivities and water diffusivities. And again, you see these two typical slopes versus now the square root of time. over larger times, larger displacement. This is just the external shape of the particles, but there were in the interior again resistances, and in this case it is really no surprise. We know that these particles do consist of many small crystallites, but again, nicely, the sizes of the individual crystallites were as expected from the NMR data, and also the sizes of the particles. Identical message from the displacement of the lithium, lithium cations and the water molecules. Of course, water at lower temperatures due to the higher diffusivity. A very particular correlation between structure and diffusion is under these conditions of special confinement when molecules are unable to pass each other. This subject referred to a single file diffusion was a reason for a nice play in our lecture hall, throwing coins, and depending on whether the face or the tail was seen, people went to the left or to the right, if it was vacant. And then, of course, you get again the propagator. I'm showing this picture since you might know two of my colleagues now, Patrick Alvosas and Frank Stallmach, have participated in this play. And of course, mathematically, you may show that then the mean square displacement is increasing only with the square root of the time rather than with the time. And most interestingly, even in this case, the propagator is still a Gaussian, but with a different time dependence of the mean square displacement. And you know this, or some of you know it, that we were lucky to find exactly such dependencies in the zeolite, which is in fact contains one-dimensional channels. And I have to say even more happy I had been that also today NMR, Russ Bowers and Sergei Masenko did find the analogous dependence looking at nano channels. So just though this is really something which happened, but of course very exceptional, since you must have real ideal systems. As further model developed, or which has been derived from diffusion in beds of zeolites, was related to the question how it is possible to find a general formalism which covers all these different situations. And though I started with the simple assumption, just take two regions with the exchange and different diffusivities, in a complicated way, even different relaxation times. And then one comes again, luckily, to such a nice formula which looks like the superposition of the diffusion attenuation in two regions, but the effective parameters of the magnitude, the fraction of the region and the diffusivities are not real values, but they have to be calculated from the diffusivities, the mean lifetimes in the two systems, or within the crystals and outside of the crystals. Yeah, it turned out to be a useful approach, but you all, if you look a little bit longer, but you see it can't be a correct description. It's just a first order approach. Can't be a correct description, but of course, it's a quite nice formula, and so I was happy to see that, for instance, you know it, Monika Schönhoff, this was my recent experience, and nicely applied this formalism in this case by looking at the exchange between polyelectrolyte capsules, just molecules in solution inside and outside. You know the fast exchange, which is now somehow combines the influence of diffusion exchange and diffusion outside, and is more inside. And what I really didn't expect, that the exact application, why is this the exact application? You see the molecules inside, if the exchange time is chosen in the correct way, move with the velocity of the capsules. And they are subject to the real diffusion law, normal diffusion, and also these molecules, if they are outside, are subject to normal diffusion. And the exchange may happen at any time. This is also very essential for this application. And this is the case in this situation. And I didn't expect it over a long time that even zeolites, we may deal with such a situation. These are quite new results, which has become possible by combining magic angle spinning and PFT NMR. And now, in this case, the two types of molecules are the water molecules inside the pore system and outside. And this is a mobile part, and those within these small cages, which are essentially captured without any diffusivity. And if we look at the next slide, this is, we are still preparing for publishing. In one case at low temperature, we see only at high observation time diffusion decay of the mobile water molecules. These are the capped molecules. At high temperatures, we know the faster, much faster decay of the mobile water. And in addition, even the captured water molecules, this line now shows the first decay. This is due to these molecules, which during these 100 milliseconds have entered the system. Now, at the end of my talk, I want to come really to physical problems which are really concerned with, and at the end with a request and suggestion, maybe you can help me to continue along this research via NMR imaging. With Rustem Bayulin entering our group, we became more open for nanoporous systems quite in general, including mesoporous materials. And mesoporous materials, as you probably know, have the particular peculiarity that on increasing the pressure and plotting the amount of molecules adsorbed in a certain range, this range, you will observe in quasi-equilibrium different amounts of molecules than on the way back. And this is just the situation, you know it from magnetism, the hysteresis range. And we did the following. We looked at molecular uptake at first outside the hysteresis, just enhancing the pressure, following the increase in concentration, as indicated here, and calculating the curve we do expect on the basis of the diffusivity which we could measure by PFG NMR. And you see a total fit, but no fit at all here in the range of the hysteresis. So again, it goes quite fast, but then it takes essentially infinitely long. And now there's of course the question, what is the reason of this? And the reason is more or less simple. As long as we are outside the hysteresis, we have only multi-layer adsorption, and increase in loading is associated with the transport of individual molecules from here to here, and this is controlled by diffusion, which we are measuring. In hysteresis, however, we do have condensation. Condensation at first as the narrowest spots, and this spot has to be transported there, and this proceeds at a different rate than the individual molecules. And what is this rate? Can we measure this? Yes, in principle, NMR should be able to do this. And this is just my last point, non-equilibrium physics. How is it possible to measure transport phenomena under conditions where we have a concentration gradient? Now I definitely have to come back to this presentation, Einstein's equation, I've referred to this in context with the NMR data. I didn't say that Einstein did also publish his paper on diffusion in Leipzig, in the Annalen of Physik. So Leipzig in some way, Leipzig diffusion, there are some connection. But what we are now interested in is just what happens under non-equilibrium condition. If there is a critic. Now, I want only to shortly mention, without going into detail, so we were lucky. Harry Pfeiffer had the great pleasure meeting Paul Lauterbuhr and getting from him the idea, just look at these phenomena by supermatography, which we did publish. And yeah, it was quite interesting, looking at a different type of uptake for large crystals and small crystals in the bed. But looking into the individual crystallites, this didn't work. And so I was happy, and you mustn't blame me, that I looked for different techniques which are able to provide this information, the evolution of concentration profiles within crystals, where the crystal have sizes of micrometers, and the relevant time scales are from seconds to hours. And these options were provided by IR microscopy, as we have checked, interference microscopy, and I do have here two examples, one concerning the transformation from benzene to cyclohexane, where you may follow the uptake of benzene here at high temperatures, a fast reaction. You see benzene under hydrogen atmosphere is converted to cyclohexane, stationary condition. For the first time, this type of information was provided, and this, for people working in this field, is known as the effectiveness factor, which so far couldn't be directly determined. We were able to do this now by microimaging. And the second thing I wanted to mention is just the phenomenon of overshooting, just observing how molecules are able, and these are the profiles here of ethane. You see the evolution of profiles. Here's anything fine from outside to inside, increase, and here you note an increase in the ethane profiles, which is only possible if the molecules which get, you know, which are transported from here to here are moving in the direction of increasing ethane concentration. But this is possible by the second component, by propene. They are driven in, and we were able to measure this by, unfortunately, not yet IR imaging, but I hope you may contact me otherwise, offer some measuring time. Leipzig has a magnetic resonance center. Maybe we can do it next time in 1 year. 1 year, I would be happy to talk about it. So I'm happy to thank very many people. Much more I have to thank this, certainly, and this, but in any case, I have to thank Harry Pfeiffer for starting my activity with this wonderful advice, looking at John Tanner's work. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Jörg, for fascinating insight, and it's stuff that a lot of us here just work in human imaging, animal imaging. We haven't seen this side of the story, so thank you for that. I suspect we're going to have some questions, so yes, please. And if I don't get the microphone to you, I will repeat the question so we can try and get it captured on the audio.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very, very much, Jörg, for this fascinating presentation. And just before I ask the question, just one little comment. I enjoyed very much staying with you in Leipzig for some years. Before then, I switched to this community, and I was very much surprised to see so many citations of your works, which actually from something different from diffusion in porous materials, especially your exchange model in the literature of this biomedical and tissue community. But my question is, you have a long life in diffusion, in looking how the ideas getting transformed from when you look to the microscopic materials, which are very well defined and having giving you from the structure already a lot of background to understand how the diffusion can be, and then going to more complex system with mesoscopic pores, which are less good defined, and it is maybe sometimes more difficult to understand what is going on there. Given this experience, what do you think, what road it would take for us to understand diffusion in even more and more complicated systems like biological tissue? Just maybe general comments.
With biological systems, sorry, I'm careful to mention anything, but I'm really very fascinated by the question, what is going on in the hysteresis range? What is the behavior of ensembles of molecules together? Is the view I have suggested, is it correct? Or is there a fluctuation in these materials, in the range of hysteresis? That what can measure this? So just the idea, do we have a chance to locate such a place within the system where there are 50 molecules within the channel or only 10? And then suddenly at another narrow place, these 50 appear. So looking at the fluctuation, in fact, also light scattering might be applicable, but unfortunately this material is not good for light scattering, but NMR, there are so many options to vary. You know it better than me. And why not looking at the interaction between the lattice and the guest molecules and looking at such fluctuations? That I thought might be a possibility. But so far I have to remain with the things I'm able to do, and this I wouldn't start. But.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Anybody else? So I guess I would, it's a sort of a slightly related question that is there anything in your field, in your particular areas of development, that you look at and think, I wish the biological community would take this up? Now, certainly towards the end of tomorrow, we're going to be hearing about some applications of things that have applied to odor concerns and ordering. But is there anything that you've kind of seen and thought, you know what, these guys are missing a trick?
Yeah. So maybe I haven't caught.
No, that's okay. I guess I'm asking. That's a colloquialism, sorry. Are there missed opportunities? Are there missed opportunities that we.
Yeah, I would be really happy. I will really listen to this and come back. Even if you don't mind with silly questions, really, maybe it's...
No, I'm used to silly questions coming from here. Okay, well, if there's no more questions, we're bang on 11 o'clock. So, once again, I'd like to show our appreciation to Jörg for a fascinating presentation.